All right, everyone. Thank you all for returning for our last formal panel of the day. And to moderate it, I turn the floor over to my colleague and university legend, Geoffrey Stone.
Thank you, Tom. So this panel, the most important of the day, will be talking about free speech on campus and academic freedom with representatives of the major national organizations that focus on these issues and therefore have thoughtful perspectives on how we can address these sorts of questions. So I will let each of you briefly introduce yourself, and then we'll turn to the substance.
Hi, I'm Alex Morey. I'm the director of campus rights advocacy at FIRE. For more than 20 years, we were the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education. Now we are the Foundation for Individual Rights and Expression, fighting for First Amendment and free speech norms across the country.
Hi, I'm Ben Wizner. I'm the director of the Speech, Privacy, and Technology Project at the American Civil Liberties Union.
And I'm Jeff Flier. I'm a physician scientist, formerly the dean of Harvard Medical School. I spent, starting from 2017, I joined the board of Heterodox Academy, and this past March, I was one of the founding members of the Council on Academic Freedom at Harvard, which is a new group that is worth knowing about.
Let's begin by talking a bit about the history and origins of these organizations. So Alex, what's the history of FIRE? When was it created? Why was it created? What is it that led to the sense that there was a need for this?
Sure. Well, you know, the thing is we've been trying to put FIRE's been trying to put itself, extinguish itself, if you will, for more than 20 years in 1999 to professors, a, you know, conservative, a libertarian, and a liberal got together and said, there are all these speech codes popping up on campuses that we don't like in violation of the First Amendment or at private schools in violation of the school's free speech promises. We should write them some strongly worded letters and say, look, you know, you can't force students to, you know, not make jokes in their emails or not say quote unquote offensive things. This is antithetical to the idea of a university. And they thought, we'll write a few letters and be done. And now FIRE's got like 150 staff members. We are suing people left and right. We've got a big litigation shop, no pressure. But you know, we are seeing a need that has, you know, expanded wildly off campuses. And for decades, we were saying campuses are the incubators for our democracy. They're these little microcosms where we're seeing a lot of the problems that we're going to be facing in society starting. And you know, this polarization issue is going to be bad. And now here we are. So FIRE is, you know, we're making sure that not only is the government following the First Amendment, but we really want to change hearts and minds in terms of having people recognize that these norms are something that is all of our birthrights and something that when we are thinking like, I don't really want to hear that speech, I want to censor that speech, we're undermining our own expressive freedoms. And that's something that not everybody, you know, understands or really wants to kind of live these days because it's a difficult thing, but that's our goal.
So how does FIRE attempt to achieve that goal?
Well, aside from suing people, which has been very effective, you know, we're an educational nonprofit. One of the most important things about FIRE is that we are like religiously nonpartisan. If you're not mad at us at some point for the speech that we defend, we're not doing it right. You know, we're out there defending TPUSA chapters that want to come onto campuses, or when, you know, the Proud Boys comedy tour is coming around, we're saying that has to be allowed on campuses. And at the same time, we're, you know, suing in Florida over the Stop Woke Act. We're suing in California for like forcing people to be too woke at the community college level. So wherever left and right are infringing these free speech rights, we are there to say, you can't do that. And just trying to educate people as well.
Mm-hmm. So Ben, what about the ACLU in this regard? I mean, the ACLU obviously was created right after or during the end of World War I. It was primarily created, as I understand it, to deal with issues involving individuals who resisted the war and were prosecuted for the war. And it's become a major national organization in protecting individual liberties, including, of course, free speech. What's its position about universities?
The ACLU is not as focused on universities as FIRE, and particularly since the advent of FIRE in the last few decades, we've been grateful for their leadership on this issue. Nonetheless, both in K through 12 education and in universities, the ACLU is still a pretty active litigant, mostly at our affiliate level, in defending free expression and academic freedom, like FIRE. We've challenged the Stop Woke Act in Florida. We have also defended the views of professors who have offended the sensibilities of people who are more in the progressive camp.
And what about Heterodox Society and the Harvard program?
Yeah, well, in brief, I mean, the Heterodox Academy was founded in 2015 by John Haidt and one colleague, and it was essentially a blog for a while. Then it became an organization, nonprofit, with an office in New York, and it began to talk about three key values that were focused on open inquiry, viewpoint diversity, and constructive disagreement from the point of view that these were essential to higher education, and they were under threat. And people weren't talking about it enough. And some of the people who were talking about it were attacking universities in general, whereas John wanted to do this from a point of view of loving higher education and universities. So this was a positive effort. It did a number of things, had a national meeting, would have various affinity groups in different fields, some of which became rather large. They gave out some awards. They did a survey that they put out for a number of years. This is what they did. They had 6,000 members across the country in every state and some 10 other countries, I believe. But the problem was, or a problem was, that people didn't quite know who the members were because someone made the decision at the beginning not to publicize it. Someone objected to their name being listed on a website. And that all changed recently, or the last couple of years, when we searched for a new president. John Tomasi is now the president. And he developed several ideas that the board was very supportive of. One now is ongoing, was to create campus communities that would be called heterodox campus communities, and people could be officially saying they believe in these values and have programs and membership and lectures, et cetera. And initially, the thought was maybe we'll have two or three, we'll announce that we're going to do this. And that was announced last November, and there were like 60 universities had faculty applying. It was way more than anyone imagined in a two-week period. Essentially 21 were chosen. Then a few months later, they put out another call. Another 60 came in as applicants. And now there's 36, I believe, of these that have been established. Get a little money from Heterodox Academy. They get a little guidance, but they're basically their own thing. And they have to just affirm those values that I mentioned at the beginning. Some of them are starting to have real interesting stuff going on at their colleges. It goes from famous Ivies to community colleges. They wanted that. They wanted to be distributed around the country, state schools, all kinds of institutions. They've also just opened a new, what do they call it? I wrote it down here. Center for Academic Pluralism was just opened this week. They hired 6 or 7 faculty fellows who will be there for a year to do research and have meetings and such. That's all really good. And I'll say one other thing that I just saw in an email last night. They announced, some of you may have heard about the American Anthropological Association canceled a session called Sex and Anthropology by 5 absolutely outstanding women anthropologists. And on November 8th, Heterodox Academy will be sponsoring that symposium that was canceled. It'll be online as well as live, and that's really good. I could say a word about the Council on Academic Freedom, which is really a new organization. The way I actually heard about it was last December when I was seeing, as a board member, the universities that were applying to have heterodox communities. I didn't see Harvard. So I called Steven Pinker, who I'd gotten to know, and I said, hey, Steve, there should be someone wanting to make one at Harvard. He says, well, I was just at a dinner last night of 10 people at the faculty club wanting to create something at Harvard, and why don't you come to the next meeting? So we had a couple of additional Zoom meetings, and then in March, end of March, we had a dinner and launched the Council on Academic Freedom at Harvard. Six co-presidents were chosen. I was somehow one of them. And then, since then, what's happened is very little public outreach, although there were a couple of op-eds about it written to announce our existence. There now are 140, 150 members. Every school at Harvard is represented. Medical school, which I'm at, has 32 members. Law school, 10 members. Philosophy department, 3 or 4 members. Government department. It's a very remarkable group across the entire political spectrum, mainly center-left, some real progressives. This is the group that exists now. We're debating and discussing what our activities will be. We passed the governance statement a couple of weeks ago. We have Professor of Philosophy Ned Hall has just, with a small subcommittee, drawn up a Harvard statement on free speech. It's a one-pager. Mm-hmm. It's a little different from every other one. It looks really good to me. We're getting ready to...
You should just copy ours.
That's, of course, that was what everybody said, but that's not what was done. And,
we'll take what we can get.
We're adding to the diversity of such statements. Ultimately, we'd like the university to adopt it, because this is just our faculty group. He gave a public lecture a couple of weeks ago. We reached out to the new president, Claudine Gay. Several of the people knew her well. She immediately set up a meeting with the leadership of the council. We had a one-hour meeting with her. Steven Pinker, in particular, was very eloquent. We implored her to put this high on her list. If you go and you look at what her inaugural speech was last week, it had about 5 paragraphs talking about just what we were asking her to do, the importance of being challenged, not being too comfortable, not being afraid to be challenged, and all of this. So we're hopeful. We're planning a couple of public events, maybe each semester. We're now having different groups work on an examination of Harvard's policies, some of the ones that people have objected to on various grounds. No one even knows what, for example, diversity policies are all across Harvard. Some schools, the law school says we'll never have one. Other schools actually have them. Others don't know if they have them, but they seem to be turning up. So we want to know what is going on, what does the university think about these, what's the evidence base. So I'll just stop there and say that, last thing I will say is that as I think was mentioned earlier about the Chicago Forum, we've had about 25 universities, faculty on them saying, how can we do something like what you've done? And just a few days ago, the University of Toronto just announced the Council on Academic Freedom at the University of Toronto, and there's about 5 or 10 more that are going to be doing that soon. And the structure is, it's a faculty-led organization. All you have to do to join is to say, I agree with these core mission statements. And it's actually not coming out of the president's office, as yours is. It is, in fact, coming out of the government department, where one of the prominent government professors started using a discretionary fund to make this happen. When you give money, and now we have donors just writing checks, alums and various people have heard about it, and it goes to Harvard University. They take their tax, and it sits in the department currently. People talked about whether we'd be better off being a separate nonprofit, but the way we're going at the moment is what I described.
So, to what extent are you aware of any differences between these various organizations in terms of conception of academic freedom and free speech?
You want me to start?
Sure.
Okay, well, I mean, you know, FIRE is in the really unique position from our early days of hearing from students and faculty themselves. You know, they are submitting cases online. They're calling us. We're combing, you know, what's happening in the news and reaching out to them. And when students are having their, you know, speakers they invite to campus shouted down, or faculty are getting non-renewed, you know, adjuncts getting non-renewed for mysterious other reasons when really they just said something controversial a few weeks before, we are hearing from the people who are getting the short end of the free expression stick at a lot of these schools, people who are expressing dissenting views, people who want to bring dissenting views to campus, people who want to, you know, and we're not just talking about, you know, we're not talking about like flat earthers or, you know, white supremacists broadly. We're talking about people who, you know, are in the race and gender department, and they have a very nuanced view of the university's DEI policies, and maybe they don't think it goes far enough, or they think it's performative, or they, you know, these are progressives that are not saying exactly the right thing, and so they are being left out of the discussion. And so FIRE, you know, when you ask what do we do, the engine of FIRE for many years, and what I still do with my campus rights advocacy team, is we figure out what's going on campuses, and we, you know, write nasty grams or tweet or write op-eds about what's going on and say, you know, hey, University of whatever, you are bound by the First Amendment if you're a public school. You cannot be suppressing speech on campus. Or, you know, the Yales, the Harvards, many, many private schools that are not bound by the First Amendment nonetheless make institutional promises that look a lot like the First Amendment. So students come to a campus and they go, I'm looking at the handbook and it looks like I have expressive rights, but you know, I can't form a chapter of TPUSA on campus, or I can't have a pro-choice protest or speaker on campus that's gonna talk about abortion because that's too, you know, too controversial. Race, abortion, COVID stuff for a while was very divisive. Basically all the issues that are problematic in our broader society, we have seen really blow up on campuses. And so, you know, FIRE, you know, my day-to-day with my team, our bread and butter is reaching out to individual institutions when they are, you know, silencing students and faculty in one way or another.
So how receptive are these institutions if you are stopping short of litigation?
You know, it really depends. Some schools are incredibly receptive. You know, ever since FIRE, you know, we've been around for a long time, but like now FIRE's running Super Bowl ads, and now we've got billboards, and now we've, you know, we're becoming more of a household name. And so when people see FIRE increasingly, there's like a name and brand recognition, so that's helpful. But for a long time, you know, it really depends on the administrators, but it varies in terms of receptiveness. But I would say, you know, we probably have about a, you know, 40 or 50% success rate, which in this climate is pretty good, at least when it comes to the, you know, our campus rights team.
So the institutions who are following a particular policy that you don't like, when you contact them,
yeah,
they will half the time listen to you and change their policies.
Well,
when they hadn't done that, when their faculty or alumni did it.
Yeah, sometimes. I mean, sometimes it's just a matter of educating administrators, and they go, "Oh, we didn't know that." Like, you know, administrators have such a tough job, and there's a range of, you know, how long has the administrator been at the school, and what is their, you know, if they're in the DEI office or the Title IX office, maybe the First Amendment and students' expressive freedoms are not top of mind for them. Maybe they, you know, are thinking about other policies first. And sometimes it's just a matter of saying like, okay, you can make sure there's not discriminatory harassment on campus. That's a great thing. But you have to know that just a student, you know, saying something off color on Twitter is not discriminatory harassment. And in fact, it's protected by your free speech policy. So sometimes it's just a matter of education.
So half the time, they don't do what you want. So what happens then?
Well, it depends.
Do they persuade you that they weren't doing anything wrong?
So we have sort of a running joke at FIRE that when we write to a lot of universities about their policies for a long time, we would get, you know, that policy was already under review. And we're like, sure. But yeah, so a lot of the time, they'll review their policy, or they'll pull it down temporarily, and then many months of meetings will go on, and then eventually something else looking better will pop up. when there is, you know, for many years, FIRE was not in the business of suing people, but then there came, you know, situations where we are seeing public universities blatantly violating the First Amendment. I think some of our initial lawsuit cases were like, a guy wanted to hand out constitutions on Constitution Day on in the open outdoor areas of campus, and the security guards are saying, you can't, you know, do free speech, and the free, or sending people to free speech zones, which are like little tiny boxes on the outskirts of campus where no one can hear you. And they're like, go to the free speech zone and, you know, shout into the ether. We have sued over those, all kinds of things. But yeah, so we, when, and our, you know, initial caseload was very successful because the law was like very clearly on our side. It was just nobody was suing over it. So we thought, you know, who better than us, and now we've got, you know, a full-blown litigation shop, and we're
so when you say, left. When you say law, I assume you're talking primarily about public universities.
Yes.
Not private.
Yes.
Not private.
Public.
So, what kind of things is ACLU doing these days in terms of these issues?
And particularly on campus issues. I mean, we're doing what we've always done on these issues. I mean, I think the big difference between the ACLU and FIRE is that the ACLU does 12 or 14 or 16 things other than doing free expression work. And candidly, those things come into tension often with free expression work. And that's not new at the ACLU. I mean, Nadine Strossen, who was here last night, in the 1990s when she was the president of the ACLU, wrote a 17-page defense under the title, you know, has the ACLU abandoned its core principles and become just another liberal interest civil rights group? And you know, 50 years ago, J. Anthony Lucas wrote a piece in the New York Times Magazine, the ACLU against itself, because of the huge debates that were roiling the organization about representing the Klan, and how that butted up against the work that the ACLU was doing for racial justice. Those tensions are real. They flare up after, for example, the ACLU of Virginia represented Jason Kessler in Charlottesville, after the George Floyd murder. They're not new, and we have a way of handling and accommodating them. I can say we still continue to do the traditional controversial First Amendment work that the ACLU has done, but I don't want to sugarcoat and, you know, pretend that we're somehow immune from the kinds of winds that are blowing in society and are buffeting liberal organizations, including universities, newspapers, and others. You know, Michael Powell was writing the perennial New York Times article is, you know, is the ACLU still committed to the First Amendment? And I said to him, you know, the ACLU and the New York Times are both indispensable liberal organizations that are under these kinds of pressures, but at least we didn't fire our editorial page editor for publishing an editorial, right? Or fire a science writer under both ex post facto and double jeopardy violations like you did. So I mean, we're still, you know, I've filed briefs supporting the National Rifle Association in a lawsuit against Andrew Cuomo. We filed a brief last week supporting a right-wing Christian group that was challenging a school discriminatory language policy because their children were offended by what they call gender ideology. The ACLU was still doing that work, but I think that the way that people now see the ACLU's work is in the context of social media, which is maybe more aimed at mobilizing our supporters than persuading the public.
So I know that Heterodox Academy is fairly new, but why did we need it? I mean, given that we had these two other organizations already, why was there a need for the Heterodox Academy?
Well, I wasn't the founder, so I wasn't thinking about it in that way. But the reason I would now say it's needed is that its goal wasn't litigation or reaching out to, you know, the leaders of other organizations where we thought there were problems, but was to create communities, eventually real communities that are occurring now, where people on campuses could know that they weren't alone. And this also relates to the even newer organization, this Harvard Council, which one of the things that I've been excited to see is on that point. And that is many people who you would not normally believe from public conversations or occasionally private, you wouldn't believe that they're very concerned about the tenor of the university campus, the culture, the ecosystem, when you have a chance to create an organization that starts to build, you realize, oh yeah, there are a lot of other people who think that, and they're brilliant people, and they're philosophers and government and law and sociology, et cetera. They're there. And once they get to know each other, which is now starting to happen at Harvard, then there's going to be some kind of systematic effect of expansion of that group, because people are just knowing that they're not alone will increase the likelihood that they will speak out. So I'll just go a little off your question and say there are two cases, and I'm not going to go into details about them, at Harvard over the last couple of years. One was a few months ago, one was 2 years ago, where terrible things happened to a faculty member in ways, one of which is largely unknown to the public, one got somewhat known. But what was shocking was that there was no defense of these individuals who were objectively, savagely wronged, okay? There was no defense by the president, by the provost, by their department chair, by colleagues. Kind of shocking. I mean,
and they were wrong for things that they did in terms of like teaching or speaking or writing?
Yes, correct. In one case, it was having signed an amicus brief 7 years earlier on a subject unrelated to their, you know, world-famous biostatistical expertise, and someone found out that they had signed an amicus brief in the Obergefell case on the wrong side. This is a devout Catholic biostatistician, and they sent out blast emails at the Harvard School of Public Health saying this person should not be here. He doesn't represent our values. And this mushroomed. He was asked to appear before multiple groups to essentially explain how he could have done that. And he was induced to make some forms of apology. No one publicly spoke out for him, although several people did speak privately and say, don't worry, it'll be okay, we'll manage this. That he has just published his two descriptions of this in an online epidemiology journal that you can get the information on and read what happened to
him. Did the university actually discipline him in any way?
No, they did not, okay? They just shocked the shit out of him and made him almost suicidal.
Now, FIRE would argue that's discipline. If you're pulling someone, you know, before a tribunal that has potential disciplinary power, even if it, you know, resolves in favor of the, I mean, that sounds pretty, you know, that sounds
like
punishment.
This is bullying, actually, by the Harvard's new bullying policy, which came out just a month ago, finally.
I can't believe it.
I would view that as bullying of him, the way he was treated. Another case was in our human evolutionary biology department, someone who got her PhD there, prize-winning teacher, co-director of the undergraduate education of that department, wrote a book on testosterone. That is a brilliant book. I've now read it. I hadn't read it before. It's on the biology, the sociology, the behavioral aspects of sexual hormones. That's what her career was all about. And the back was blurred by some of the most famous scientists in the world. In the effort to market her book tour, she appeared mistakenly, in retrospect, on one of the Fox News things where they asked her the simple question, do you believe there's men and women? And she said, of course. And she spoke for 2 or 3 minutes about the biological aspect of sex. Not that it's the only aspect, but it is an aspect. The next day, blast emails went out. She shouldn't be allowed to teach. She makes us hurt by her presence. She's a transphobe, which was completely and utterly untrue, but it was stated. And she, to make a long story short, she left the department and isn't teaching anymore, and is now writing.
Left the whole university or just the department?
She was non-tenured. She was a lecturer for 20 years, and she left that position in her department completely. And Steven Pinker heroically gave her a lecturer position in an office in the psychology department, from which she is now writing another book.
So why wasn't the criticism of her just free speech, that you should be protected?
Why wasn't there?
Yeah.
No.
Good question.
No. Why weren't her critics just exercising their...
Yeah, that's what I'm, right.
Oh, well, I guess they were. And I don't think the question is they shouldn't have been allowed to speak. What the university, as a university, any university I would want to be associated with, the leaders, knowing that this was a terrible treatment of her and based on no solid ground evidence at all, would speak out, either as the leaders, as the deans, as the provost, or just personally. But none of that occurred. So,
but what would you have had them done, do in that situation? Just to say, you all have the right to free speech, you can criticize it all you want, but that's it.
Correct.
And, that's what it says in Harvard policy.
Yeah.
You know, like Harvard has a great free speech policy, and it says faculty have academic freedom. It says, you know, it's in the handbook, but it didn't pan out here.
Yeah, but I think where it goes wrong is when officials send out blast emails criticizing a faculty member in their role as administrative leaders. I mean, we could talk about that. That is a problem, and it may not be a problem of violating a specific policy, but it's a problem of the integrity of the university. And I would say, I don't want to be at a university where something like that happens and the actual department chair who had a blurb on the back of her book does not defend her book.
But why can't the faculty members criticize her also? Including
why can't the faculty members criticize her?
Yeah.
They can criticize her. There's nothing wrong with criticizing her. The problem is a cultural problem that people would not defend her. So I'll just get, since you're asking, I'll just do one additional thing. So when I read the article in the Harvard Crimson the next day reporting that this terrible thing had happened, that the graduate students were demanding that she should not be allowed to be there anymore, I ordered the book from Amazon. I got it the next day. I read it that day. I'm an endocrinologist. I used to run the endocrine course at Harvard Medical School before I became dean. It was a brilliant book. It was not only scientifically correct, but it was a brilliant act of science journalism for the general public. And so I contacted her. We had a long Zoom session together. She was telling me she didn't know what she was going to do. She was very, very unhappy. I said, well, what about your department members, you know? And she said, well, none of them want to speak in my defense. So I said, can I reach out to your chair, who had written on the back of her book? I had a Zoom with him. He told me, look, her book is fantastic. The argument against her that's being circulated is false. I said, but have you said anything about that? Have you sent out an email to your faculty? He said, no, it would be viewed as punching down on the graduate student, and I can't do that. I said, what you've said to me does not make any sense to me. I said, is there any way I can help? He said, why don't you write a supporting letter? So I spent the day writing a two-page defense of her book. I watched her appearance on Fox. I said, there's nothing that she said there that was wrong. And I said, please feel free to distribute this. He distributed it to his entire faculty of about 25. And the next day, I got about 8 or 9 emails from senior faculty, some of whom I knew by reputation already. And they said, thank you for doing this and doing what I couldn't do. And in every case, my answer was, question was, well, why couldn't you do it? And none of them ever responded. So this points to a corrupt culture. Okay, this is a corrupt culture that has been revealed by one episode.
How much pushback did you get from what you wrote?
I got to the faculty, none. I got no pushback. No one.
It didn't go out beyond the faculty.
I said, if you want to send this to the entire Harvard University, if you want me to submit it to the Harvard Crimson, please do. They didn't do that.
What about the individual who was the victim of this?
What did she do?
Did you give her the right to do that?
She had the right to do that.
She eventually.
Eventually. She became extremely depressed, as you might imagine. And she stopped going into her office before she quit. And she eventually wrote an article that came out about 6 months ago that describes what happened to her in a peer-reviewed scientific journal in her field.
Because this is obviously an interesting situation, but it's not really the larger situation that we're all concerned about in terms of what's happening on university campuses. So let's turn more broadly.
Yep.
Just to be clear, though, this kind of stuff is happening on campuses all over the country. It is happening every day. We hear from faculty every day, particularly adjuncts who are incredibly vulnerable. They don't have the kinds of due process protections that tenured faculty have. And I think adjuncts, contingent faculty make up like something like 3/4 of all faculty now.
But don't the people who are criticizing them, aren't they simply exercising the rights that you're supposed to protect?
Yes, but then at some point, administrators have to say, let's have a discussion about this rather than we're going to punish the dissenter when she had every right to express her, views and criticisms as well.
Right. So one of the larger questions that is going on these days is the sense that there's a lot more efforts to suppress speech by students, by faculty, by others, than has been true in recent decades. And that's had a significant impact on the academic culture of colleges and universities. Why do you think that's happening?
I'll go first here. And I think there's a tendency to say, what is it with these students? And there are some explanations that are predicated on how these students might have been raised differently. But I actually think we have to focus on the adults because college students have always, among other things, gone there to test their power. And you're not just there to read a great books curriculum. You're there to try out ways of being an adult. And one of the ways that you try out being an adult is to test the limits of what power you have in these institutions. And the answer that they're getting is you have a lot of power in this institution. And so when I was 19 years old, outside protesting Mobutu Sese Seko when he was speaking at the Harvard Kennedy School, I would have loved to cancel his appearance. But that wasn't on the table. Mm-hmm. We were outside. And so when you put canceling the event on the menu, students are going to order it. And so this is, we heard about Winnicott in that very wonderful interview a minute ago, right? So when you're confronted with that demand from students, this is not a situation where they can be treated like the customer. There have to be pretty clear limits about what's negotiable here and what's not. And I disagree with one of the speakers earlier who said that students aren't here to be activists. Now, that's an important thing to learn. Students should be activists here. And I think it's wonderful that students have been activists for laborers on campus to earn more than the minimum wage, or to advocate for a diverse faculty, or to push for their universities to have better climate policies and to divest from fossil fuels. These are wonderful things for students to be trying out, but I think what happens is, just as students are trying to test their power, the universities themselves are competing for students. And they are terrified. So this is why I think there's a collective action problem. They're terrified of having the reputation of being a university that is not safe for students of color or not safe for activists. And so they cater to students who demand that speakers be canceled. And unless the universities in some kind of more collective way say, this is actually a line. Protesting in this way is encouraged. Protesting in that way is a subject of discipline. As the Chicago principles lay out, then we're going to have the problem. But I think that laying it at the feet of the students isn't all that helpful.
So are students now being much more aggressive about these issues than they were 10, 20 years ago?
Well, it depends which issues. I mean, you were a student at a time when when students were taking over buildings
in order to silence people.
I do think there's a different discourse around the harms of speech that feels a little bit new. And I do think one of the things that we have in universities right now is even as we have presidents and faculty who are espousing certain liberal values, we also have bureaucratized administrators who are espousing values that could be but are not always consistent with those values. And so I do think that the diversity efforts need to be aligned with the school's free speech mission and not be used to undermine the free speech mission. And what I mean here is that I do think that there's a tendency to, in fact, train students to view discomfort as trauma, to view disagreement as erasure, and that kind of rhetoric kind of escalates the stakes of these kinds of demands. You're not just disagreeing with me. You're trying to make me disappear and not exist. And I think that is a way in which these conversations around speech feel different than they did to me in the 1990s when I was a student.
So part of the problem is that students are being more aggressive than they were before because they can get away with it.
Part?
Well, I would just make one modification there. It doesn't mean all students or even most students. And what's happened is there are a certain number of students who engage on this, and they do so very effectively in a way that spreads and makes other people unwilling to voice opposition. So it's an interesting psychodynamic with social media and their behaviors that make a relatively small number. It's not a tiny number, but it's not anything like 30, 40, 50% able to influence the course of events much more powerfully than they could in the past. When I think back when I was in college in the late 60s at City College of New York, there was a lot of student activism, but there was no way you could spread it apart from being part of a group that met to try to argue about the Vietnam War. You couldn't do it by just doing something on your phone and suddenly it blows up.
So students of this generation have much more, again, capacity mm-hmm. to get attention. And universities are uncomfortable trying to discipline them for that because they have free speech rights. And so you've got this kind of complication here where on the one hand you want to give students free speech rights, but on the other hand, their free speech is causing problems for others. Right.
Well, I wasn't talking about free speech. I don't consider shutting down a speaker free speech. Protesting a speaker is free speech, but as you know, right?
Right.
Yeah. So.
Right.
No one should be disciplined for free speech. So.
So okay. So suppose a professor in a history class tells the students that slavery was a good thing, that it was good for the owners and for the slaves. And obviously this upsets lots of students. Can the university do anything in that situation? Or is that just okay? That's just faculty member prerogative.
Well, I'll jump in on that. That would be like at a medical school, you have someone teaching pathophysiology of disease, and they say diabetes and obesity have no negative health consequences. I'd have that person out of there teaching that course in a second.
Because it was factually false.
Yes, it's factually false.
Is what I just described factually false?
It's much more difficult. It's much more difficult. And I think that when you open the door to viewpoint discrimination, then you have the Stop Woke Act in Florida, where Governor DeSantis says the viewpoint that we're going to ban is wokeism. And so I think that the gray area here is that schools can ensure quality control, expertise, that people are actually leading scholars in their field, and there probably aren't very many leading scholars in a field who would be invited to be a historian teaching that subject. And it would not be viewpoint discrimination to say that what you're doing falls below professional standards here.
Well,
I say it's a gray area because what I just said could be used in a way as a smokescreen for viewpoint discrimination.
But part of what you suggested is that the department should not hire people who hold views that are offensive, not actually factually wrong, but offensive. Now that's inconsistent with free speech, isn't it?
No, I mean, I wasn't, that's not what I said.
Sure, because that was the experience of this faculty member, and he applied for a job at University X, and they didn't hire him because they didn't want this guy saying these things in their classes. Would ACLU support his right to do that?
If it were a public university, someone should not be denied employment on the basis of viewpoint. And if they said, we're denying you employment because of your viewpoint, then yes, the ACLU would support the professor.
But that's the black box, as you know, the guy writes on his diversity statement, I would like this job, I think slavery was great. And then they say, well, you know, we're gonna filter you out, Fred, not because of what your views, but for other reasons, you know, wink, wink. And that's happening routinely. And of course, you know, I think the premise of your question that, like, you know, there are lots of professors in classrooms going around saying, like, slavery is great, 2 + 2 = 5, you know, the earth is flat. Like, that is not happening on a broad scale at all. There are things where, you know, I mean, faculty departments are, you know, working broadly as they should in terms of making sure, you know, someone is up to the scholarly level to teach in that department. It's the much more nuanced disagreements, like what Jeff was talking about at Harvard, things where people are not, you know, willing to engage with the level of nuance to figure out what's really happening here. They're just hearing buzzwords about, you know, these broader conversations and going, anybody that's going to say anything that I don't, you know, completely agree with about trans rights, like they should not be here. And that is incredibly detrimental to a university where that's the exact place where you want to be having the nuanced, you know, deep in the weeds conversations about these issues. But it's not, you know, there's not just like a bunch of old white racist professors everywhere that are trying to say, you know, old white racist professor stuff and them against the world. It's really a much more, you know, it's just not this level of crisis. Instead, it's adjuncts who are like, you know, I read from Mark Twain and then my contract was like not renewed because a student reported me. Or, you know, there was a DEI faculty, like she was the head of the DEI department in California and she ended up being fired because she was saying like, I don't think these DEI initiatives are quite enough or I think they're too performative. She lost her job. You know, we just don't have universities full of professors that are saying things that we all pretty much agree with are factually untrue. Instead, they want to have deep discussions on these courses.
But all things that we all believe are factually untrue, 50 years ago, if a professor wanted to say same-sex is good, that would have been the same example.
Same-sex marriage?
Yeah, so well, same-sex good, whatever.
Yeah. Okay.
I mean, if a professor taught that in the class,
right,
that would be analogous to the hypothetical I gave.
Well, I mean,
so it would be okay to fire the professor for that?
Well, I mean, we have, did you say 50 years ago? What?
Yeah, I said, I mean,
well, so in 1957, we have Sweezy versus New Hampshire. He's being asked to, you know, effectively disavow communism. And the Supreme Court is saying he should not have to be forced to do that. Any, you know, straitjacket on our faculty is going to threaten our democracy. Instead, we should be making sure not to, you know, to censor people. Then that comes Keishian, where, you know, no imposition of orthodoxy on campuses is acceptable under the First Amendment. So on public campuses, I mean, the law is very clear. Academic freedom is a corollary of the First Amendment, and that means that, you know, universities should not be stepping in when faculty have views that they dislike. I mean, yeah, you know, go back to even, you know, the 80s and 90s, and we have all these like great progressive, you know, feminists, all this, you know, the Catherine McKinnons and all their work. And that was incredibly, you know, incredibly shocking to many people at the time. Now it's like, you know, their whole department's devoted to that. And so we need people that are moving discourse forward, but also other people to challenge that, and that's how you build.
But then knowledge. The question goes about, let's say, hiring. If a person applies for a job at a university, and the faculty says we're not going to hire him because we think his views about, again, let's say it's homosexuality, 50 years ago, is not good scholarship, not good research, right? It's just wrong-headed, right? What I'm asking is, how far would you go in protecting the First Amendment rights of the candidates, or you say it's okay for the university to decide not to hire that person because they have the prerogative of deciding certain viewpoints are wrong.
If it was clear, kind of what Ben said, you know, if it was very clear that there were, you know, that viewpoint discrimination was involved, it's the problem is it's not always clear.
Well, hiring is really hard. You heard your friend.
The example I gave is pure viewpoint discrimination.
You heard your friend Erwin Chemerinsky say on tape, don't take notes. Because they might be subject to freedom of information, right? Hiring is tricky, and you're not going to be able to use law to root out that kind of improper discrimination in hiring. Firing is a lot clearer because a basis has to be stated,
right?
And then it can be defended. I think.
But if a professor in class, let's say again 50 years ago, said, you know, same-sex sex or marriage are moral and good. And the university said, you can't say that. That's absurd, and it's offensive. Would you defend them?
Of course.
Yeah?
The professor? Of course.
So there's nothing a professor could say in class now that you would not defend?
No, that's not true. I think it depends. Like a professor could say, could personally insult a student, and I wouldn't, or disparage a student. And I think that's an important line.
But that's not free speech.
That's not viewpoint discrimination.
No, that's exactly right. So no, I think there isn't any viewpoint that is indefensible, but I think there are some viewpoints that will sound so absurd that they don't seem consistent with someone's, you know, status or expertise. I think that's more true in the sciences than it would be in the humanities.
Well, in the academy that I've lived in for 40 plus years, and when a hiring decision is being made in a certain field, let's say genetics or let's say public health, what is happening is a group of people on the committee and then ultimately the department and then the school and the university have to approve that this is a good choice to be a new member based on their scholarship, their potential, the quality of what they work on. And they may, in making those decisions, be excluding some people because they don't like the stuff they're working on. Their viewpoints or where they're going with the work, what the impact will have. That is inherent to the, I believe, what happens in almost all good academic organizations. That's not viewpoint discrimination from a free speech point of view. That's trying to build an academic group that is the goal of the university and the department.
What I'm doing here is just pressing how far you go with this protection of free speech and viewpoint in this particular context.
The example when I was in college was, you know, Charles Murray, who was doing race and IQ work. And this was incredibly controversial at the time. And there were people who were making all kinds of arguments for why he should, you know, lose his tenure. And I think the right solution there is don't take his class.
Right.
And I actually do think that there are the middle ground here would be maybe don't put someone like that in front of a mandatory class, right? So that
that's also a viewpoint.
It is viewpoint. Yeah, it's not losing his job. Yes,
right.
I agree, but I do think that being a college president is not so easy. And there may be times when just saying, okay, you don't have to take this person's class, but tenure and academic freedom and the First Amendment require that this person not lose his job is something I can live with.
So I want to go to the broader question now about what's going on in universities in terms of the cultural questions. What do you think is causing at the moment the fact that there's this sense of crisis on college and university campuses in terms of free speech? That is, the unwillingness of many students to be able to say things they believe they should be able to say, and they're not doing it. What's making that happen?
So we've talked about, there are a number of panels today have addressed the relentless social surveillance of social media. And I really do think that that's probably a massive factor here, which is that one of the key parts of developing a persona, personality, is to be able to try out different identities, different ideas, and we're now in a remorseless environment.
But what do we do about it? I mean, I agree with you. A large part of what seems to me to be problematic today is the ability to really punish people in a way you couldn't in the past by using social media for things they say that you don't want them to say. So the question is, what do universities do about that right now?
Well, one of the things that, you know, poor Paul in the front row there, you know, as a university president, you make your life a lot easier when you point to, you have excellent free speech policies, and then you point to them every time in controversies, big and small, and then the expectation from the student body becomes censorship is not on the menu here at the University of Chicago or here at the university or college of wherever. And you know, one of the things that's impressed me so much about, you know, getting to meet some of the students here at the University of Chicago is, you know, they talk about, you know, I'm getting a really robust education here. I feel like we can have debates on issues like abortion and race and all that in my classes, and I'm not worried about that. That is not what we hear from students at a lot of other schools.
And what people worry about is not necessarily that the professor will think that's a bad idea or anything. It's that people will then put on social media
right.
that this person did that.
But
what do we do about
it? Maybe there's some norm creation that can be done. I mean, go to a lot of meetings. I would never sign a non-disclosure agreement. I just don't, as a matter of principle. But I do agree to what we call Chatham House rules, where we're in a meeting and we agree that we're not going to attribute what is said to any person. I think that's a very sort of powerful norm that we could sort of start to discuss. Let's make the classroom a place where we're not going to attribute. Now, it's not enforceable. It's not going to get rid of all of the chill. Someone still could.
Well, why is it enforceable? Couldn't you say that in order to be admitted into the college, you have to sign this agreement?
Oh, I mean, I suppose you could make it enforceable in that sense. I still think people would be able to evade it without detection. And get away with it. So I don't think it'll solve the problem of chill, but I do think that we should distinguish spaces, even on a campus, and we should try to inculcate the norm that, look, we're all trying to explore things together. That's impossible to do in an environment where people think that one mistake is going to be fatal to their social life and their career, and let's agree to do this together. Again, I think there's a collective action problem, and I think that this needs to be not just something that is you know, one or two schools do, but that we think about a little bit more collectively.
And one thing that's interesting about the current moment is that historically, it has been, almost without exception, conservatives who were suppressing liberals, whether it was during World War I or whether it was during the Cold War or during Vietnam or the Civil Rights Movement. And now it's flipped for the most part. Why do you think that's happened?
Well, I mean, I think, you know, a decade ago, maybe that was true, where it was like, you know, everybody on the left is, you know, trying to stop conservative speakers on campus or get conservative students to be quiet because, you know, universities are broadly left-leaning and conservative speech was unpopular. But now, with all of the legislative challenges to, you know, critical race theory and things like that, you know, at least when it comes to faculty, we are seeing, you know, it's almost an even split in terms of pressure from left and right, you know, pushing back against faculty of opposing ideology. So, I mean, right now, it's really a very accurate reflection of the polarized state of our country, and it's not so much you know, just conservatives being silenced anymore, although that definitely happens too.
I mean, maybe I'm wrong, but my impression is that's happening much more often now in college campuses than liberals being silenced.
Well, I mean, you know, I mean, that's just, at least in the faculty context, that is not what we're seeing. We see a lot of, you know, conservative activists, you know.
About students, though.
Oh, among students? Yeah, I mean, students still broadly do lean left. It really does depend on the school. But yeah, I mean, we do see a lot of pressure from the left to silence conservatives. You know, we saw Stanford Law School, Cornell, there was a shout down of Ann Coulter. I mean, many of the recent shouting down Riley Gaines at UC Davis, it's almost all a conservative group is trying to bring a conservative speaker to campus, and the protesters are broadly progressive.
Well, the irony here, I'm saying, is historically it was almost always the opposite. So the question is, how do we educate students that they have to not do this? This is wrong. This is wrong-headed.
I mean,
they have a right to do it if they want to, but they shouldn't exercise the right.
But they don't have the right to. So peaceful protest is great. when you shout down a speaker, that's not peaceful protest.
Right,
that's,
granted.
You know, disruptive misconduct. And so step one is that universities need to enforce that. Step two is create a place for the peaceful protest right outside so that they can model, like, here's how we have, you know, we have the event, we have the protest, then create avenues for just more discussion on campus, because clearly whatever the problem is a big issue. And hey, we're at a university, this is the place where we ought to be discussing this, and model for students, like, you know, our universities are these, you know, little incubators for democracy. It's not just filling students' brains with knowledge and sending them out, but teaching them how do we engage with the world's problems in a way that's going to be productive and make a difference. I mean, that's what activists on every side say they want, and universities should be in the business of showing them how they do it. And if students don't know how, that's a job for, you know, the grown-ups in the room in terms of administrators and faculty who have seen, you know, how we knowledge build and how we engage with each other for decades.
That's so this is a mission, though, that universities in the current world should take seriously about finding ways to educate students that they need to be willing to listen to each other and not try to silence each other.
One of the nice things we can say to law students is this thing that you feel so certain of, that you believe is an incontrovertible truth, when you leave this institution is a view that's shared by about 20% of the population. And your job that we're training you for is going to be to persuade others. And those people you're going to have to persuade, some of them are federal judges. 2/3 of those were appointed by conservative presidents. Others are people who, right? So you don't get to stand up in court and say, don't say that, that denies my existence. That, no, that's very uncomfortable. But if you actually want to change the world and not shout about it, you're going to have to find the language for persuading people who don't agree with you today. And I do think, and I don't know how much campus reflects the world or how much it's actually an incubator or whether these things are dynamic in other ways, but I have found more so in the last few years that people are emerging from liberal institutions with absolute conviction more than curiosity.
So Tom says we should have questions. Who's going to do that?
Hi, good afternoon. Thank you so much for the talk. My name is Christopher. I'm a third year at the college. I'd like you to speak a little bit on the importance of institutional neutrality, of having the institutions and the universities protect both sides' right to speak. We heard about the tragedy at Harvard when the university didn't really stick up for one side, but then what does that mean in terms of we don't want the universities to show special treatment to one side or the other? What is the importance of institutional neutrality, the importance of institutional neutrality in protecting free speech for all?
Well, I'll make a comment. It's the Kelvin report, I believe. Mm-hmm. Yes. I only became aware of it a year or so ago, and I found it quite illuminating and inspiring. It went against everything else I had been living through over the last 20 years, where more and more what I would see and people would want me to endorse when I led an institution was we have to make statement of institutional values. Now, of course, there are institutional values, but when you start drawing institutional values so broadly that they incorporate particular moralities, ideologies that may not be broadly accepted, not just because, you know, some people are wrong and some are right, but they are part of a pluralistic society. And I have been seeing, and I think all of you have been seeing, statements of institutional values that go into, start to, you know, engage with politics, ideology, and selective points of view, that once you say those are the institutional values, then you could say, well, I even saw something came out of a university that I know was arguing that if a faculty member violated university values, that could be enough for denial of tenure. Now, they hadn't thought that through. They didn't say actually what you would do under what circumstance. They never play out the details, but it is a chilling thing to be told on the website of Harvard Medical School that we have a new set of institutional values. They include A, B, C, and D. You could lose your tenure if you violate those. They don't say who's going to decide that, how they're going to decide that. There's no special panel for saying you've, but it's out there as a threat, and that is how I view it. And the only way, again, to defeat that is to have institutional leaders with integrity who understand it, who tell the people reporting to them that this is not acceptable, we will not do that. We have institutional values, but we're not going to draw them in this fashion so that we chill the ability and the inclination of our faculty to speak out on important issues where their views are necessary if we're going to reach the truth.
Yeah, I have something to add. You know, the most famous line of the Calvin Report is that the, and I think we've talked about this you know, last couple of days, is that, you know, the university is the host of critics. It is not the critic itself. And, you know, FIRE as an organization, we have long, you know, looked at the Calvin Report and thought, well, you know, I'm not sure if we should tell universities that they like should, that they have to do this, because, you know, universities do sort of have their own expressive rights to weigh in on social and political issues. But in the last year or so, we have, after, you know, doing this work for like 20 years, we have, you know, reconsidered and actually are going to officially endorse the Calvin Report and say that we think fist pump from president in the front. FIRE is going to endorse the Calvin Report and say, you know, we think that universities and colleges do themselves a big favor when they take, you know, taking a stand on a political or social issue out of the equation and instead say, that's for you all to do here at this university. We have seen the problems that choosing other paths has caused, and we hope that it will, you know, it will encourage free discussion when faculty know that their research isn't going to, you know, make angry the president who last week made an opposing political statement about the thing you're researching. I mean, there is a broad sort of chill that happens when universities do that.
Ben, you want to add to that?
Yeah, I mean, I have some ambivalence here. I think universities have to be absolutely committed to procedural neutrality and need to make clear in the first sentence of any statement that our rules are going to apply equally and we're going to protect everybody equally. I do encounter situations where I don't find it inappropriate for the university to make a statement of its own values. I remember, you may remember, a speech controversy that happened at Harvard Law School in the early 90s when one of their professors was murdered in front of her own home. And then a bunch of sniveling shit law students chose that as an opportunity to publish a parody of her legal scholarship. Now, should they be punished? No. But should the university say this is repulsive? And can the university, can the law school, can the dean kind of say that on behalf of the university? I think so. Yeah, I think the university can say this goes against our values as an institution to do something like this, even as we protect your right to do it.
Well, you know, we were debating a little bit last night, and I'll bring it up now because it's an issue that I have dealt with. So what's the difference between an institutional leader at different levels, you know, president, provost, deans, whatever, making a statement as the leader, speaking, quote unquote, for the school officially, versus making a statement on an issue that is very important to them and making it very clear it's their personal view? And I guess we had a little bit of a tension over whether at certain levels, can you do that? Can you get away with that? Or are you automatically going to be viewed as, people will interpret you as speaking for the institution?
Well, the Calvin Report's been understood to draw exactly that distinction.
Yeah.
And presidents of the university are very aware of that. And so they will almost always say, if it's relevant, I'm speaking on my own behalf, not for the university.
Yeah. Right. But it's not very well understood. And what I would like to see, and I've written one piece about this a few years ago, I'd like to see more institutional leaders, because they have great influence, they could be public intellectuals, they should more often, you know, take off their robes and say, I am now speaking as a person of a certain kind who has received a certain position, And this is my view on the subject. And they shouldn't be attacked because not everybody agrees with that, mm-hmm. or they shouldn't be attacked because the university isn't officially taking that view. And that's an interesting point. And people who have been in those roles are aware of what the, you know, what the issues are. Maybe boards of trustees don't like it when their presidents do such a thing because it may cause confusion, especially if their point of view is a little bit heterodox.
Okay, yeah, so I was curious. So like, as a student here, like I feel pretty comfortable saying stuff in classes or like to other students, but I do feel like it's gonna go on social media. I'm like pretty comfortable with that. Like I feel like people will know that. So do you think that like at other universities, it's really the duty of like other kids not to post it on social media? Or is it just more of a thing of like, other people have, people just have to be comfortable saying stuff and knowing that like, you know, not too much bad is going to happen, even if people find out?
Well, I mean, I think it does come down to norms, you know, like I think in classes and at schools where there is a respect for free speech values and what can be gained by talking across difference, there's not that like desire to, you know, out people on social media for saying something that is, you know, anti-whatever. I think that when that is sort of, you know, inculcated from day one, from orientation, from applications, from, you know, in every class that faculty are saying, you know, in this class, we're going to work through things, you know, in a collaborative way, and people might make mistakes, and that's okay. And, you know, the more that students understand that in their own lives as a good rather than as a threat to them, I mean, I think that's how we see that threat disappear. Easier said than done, but I think we need to model how this talking across difference, you know, feels really good. It feels really good to like get to know somebody else and realize like, hey, I have more in common with that guy than I thought. We've all had those experiences, but I think for a variety of reasons in society today, there are fewer opportunities for that. And when university administrators, you know, continue to take actions that, you know, divide, pit people against each other, you know, accuse, everybody's accusing each other of hate speech, that sort of thing, that is not fostering that kind of culture. Instead, we really want to be, you know, talking more. So I don't think there's an easy answer. I think that it is going to be about, you know, helping students learn that living, you know, walking the free speech talk is a good thing and helps them in their own lives.
Hi. So this has been a fabulous panel. Thank you very much. I have a question about how to have conversations. This morning we heard about David French saying, you know, from the right there are these arguments to try to cancel or ban books, et cetera, on the basis of the feared consequences of people being persuaded about these views. But there's a different kind of argument about canceling speech or banning speech or deplatforming or not allowing people to speak, which has to do with the speech itself, not the consequences of what happens if someone believes it or if they're persuaded. Those are the arguments that some people touched on earlier about denying somebody's humanity or people feeling hurt. This was something that happened recently with Coleman Hughes's TED Talk, where some of the responses were that this TED Talk should not be allowed to see the light of day. Why? Not because people could be persuaded to his perspective. At least that wasn't the argument that was given at the time. The argument was the talk itself is dangerous. It's harmful. It hurts people to hear it. How do you deal with these? The difference between the kind of argument you can have about what kind of speech or where the limit should be, and then the arguments that people say you can't even have the debate.
This will be the last question I'm told, so you guys can.
Look, speech is powerful, and books do persuade. I understand why parents are anxious about what books their kids are going to see, because those books are probably going to change their lives. They change mine. And words can persuade and words can offend and deeply, deeply harm. I mean, for me, I'm not going to talk somebody out of that. I'm not going to say, no, actually, these words are not harming you. what I'm going to say is, if you have a proposal for how to deal with this that doesn't involve a decision maker, tell me what that proposal is. And now who's that decision maker? You think it's always going to be the Berkeley School Board, but it's not. And in most situations, it's going to be someone who views a lot of your ideas as threatening. I understand that's in some sense, a not satisfying answer. It's an instrumental answer. It's not a values-based or sort of deeply normative answer. It just is, there is no way for us to kind of devise a system for giving someone that authority that isn't going to come out, in our view, wrong half the time.
Thank you.
Well, I want to thank all of you for your participation in the events since last evening and then throughout the day today, and our efforts to look at the topics related to academic freedom, free expression, viewpoint diversity, our efforts to try to sponsor, to enhance our own abilities at all levels to have dialogue across difference and to have a genuine truth-seeking culture. In so many ways, this university has struggled for that in every era. And the canon will help, of course, for each of you to see that history. I think this is a moment, and I hope that the many panels helped illuminate why, that this is a period where the challenges are of a different kind than others that we have seen. And in my opinion, this requires a somewhat different kind of response. And I hope that you will view this event as a first experiment, as a beginning, not an end, and that you will see the forum as a place for the constant struggle to get this right, that we will do this over in different ways, bringing different kinds of ideas, so that together the forum can be an open place where we struggle together to uphold the highest values of the knowledge creation that universities should always uphold, but that are so hard to do in practice. That's the intent of this forum, and you're invited to be a part of it as long as you are willing to. So it's ours, not anyone's, but we can make of it something much better. Thank you.
Thank you, and I just want to say a final word. Thanks, of course, to everyone who's been attending these, but also the hundreds of people from all over the world who've been beaming in online over the last day and a half or so. You know, they say inquiry at the University of Chicago is relentless, and we started at 4 p.m. yesterday. I was at the Night Elves till midnight, and we've gone all day today. And we're not done, because there's going to be a reception I want to invite you all to, which is at the Logan Center for the Arts. It's three blocks down that way. We'll have some students to help people walk. And it's the opening, it's a sort of pre-opening of an exhibit by a group of Southside artists on freedom of expression. So we are engaging with our community in this regard and hope to continue to do that at the forum. A final thank you. I couldn't thank everyone if I would be too long to thank everyone. So I'm going to do it in a very, it would be under-inclusive if I tried to list everybody. So I'm going to be a little over-inclusive. I want to thank everyone named Megan in this room and everyone who works with someone named Megan. So thanks for everything you've done to make this possible.